Prosecutors accuse Baltimore City Council President Nick Mosby of lying on his taxes.
Nick Mosby is now off the witness stand. He testified over 2 days.
Well, the Baltimore City Ethics Board closed its investigation into City Council President Nick Mosby. Mosby was accused of violating the board's rules. The Ethics Board told 11 News today Nick Mosby complied with the order banning him from fundraising for the fund.
So I'm very excited, man, to sit down with my good friend, Mr. Nick Mosby, City Council President. Man, thank you for coming, man. It's been a long time. I'm excited to have you here. First of all, I'm honored. I'm privileged, man. You're a very busy guy. I just found out that you are the second most important person in the city.
Uh-oh.
I thought about that because I was like, you know, when you think about politics, people don't understand that that's the president, the vice president, and then the Speaker of the House.
Yeah.
And in Baltimore, it's the mayor, then the city council president.
Yeah.
So God forbid something happened to the mayor, but we have seen in recent times where city council presidents replace mayor for things that don't really have anything to do with them being elected, right? So I said, Dad, you know, Nick, I remember in 2016 he ran for mayor.
Yeah.
But before we get into the politics, I want to give people an opportunity to know who is Nick Mosby. Like, I know you come from Northwood.
Yeah.
I did my research. You went to Poly.
Yeah.
Now, only smart people go to Poly. Because when I was coming up, you either go to Dunbar for basketball, Warburg for the girls, right? Uh-huh. And then you went to any other city high school that was in your district. But you went to Poly. Was that an education decision or based on you being from that part of town?
So I always tell people I'm mixed.
Mixed?
So, yeah. So my mother's from the west side. She's from Franklin Square.
Right.
Right at the Viaduct. You know, my father's from East Baltimore, like Landville and Broadway.
Okay.
And I tell folks all the time, I grew up in a house with six women, three-bedroom house, man in my house since I was 1 day old in Northwood, where I shared a bedroom with my mother and my sister until I was like 14 years old. Watched her every single day wake up 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, catch 2 buses to Social Security, put food on our table. Now, I'm the first person in my family to go to college. And for some reason, when I was younger, it was always my grandmother, my mother. My grandmother, she was the oldest person in the house. She was the matriarch of the family. You know, they would just instill with me that I was going to go to college and this is what I was going to do. So, you know, I'm just thankful for, I guess, the opportunities that they really kind of steered me in to be able to go to college, major in electrical engineering, and come back to Baltimore.
Yeah, because you went to Tuskegee, right?
Yeah,
you
know, all the way in Alabama.
I was did my research. I was like, okay, he go from Baltimore, Alabama. And I don't know any type of racial disparities at that time, but I know anything deep in the South, they had these racial issues, you know what I'm saying? Was you fearful going to Alabama?
Well, it was just something different. I wanted to get away. I wanted to get away from Baltimore, do something different. I was in a program called Upward Bound at the time, and they took us on this college tour, and ultimately that's how I selected to go to Tuskegee. But I was just excited for like new opportunities. You know, I went there on there not knowing anybody. But, you know, Tuskegee is in a town that's predominantly African Americans, one of the poorest places in all of Alabama, and Alabama is one of the poorest states. So as it relates to like racial tension or any issues like that associated with, you know, what we hear about in Alabama, Mississippi, you know, I wasn't really exposed to that. Now, traveling to Tuskegee was always interesting. You know, because it doesn't have an airport or anything like this. So
No.
So I have to fly to like Atlanta or Birmingham, and then I would bus it, Greyhound. So, you know, spending nights in Greyhound station, sleeping on my stuff. One time I don't say hitchhiking, but one time I got stuck in Birmingham for like a day. And this guy saw me. I was talking to the guy at the counter about like when was the next bus that was going to get me to Tuskegee. And an older gentleman overheard it. He's like, I'm going in that direction. I had already slept on my bags the night before. So I was like all, you know, a little upset that I was going to have to spend a night in the bus station again. And this guy was like, nah, I'm going that way. I'll take you.
See, that's interesting because even growing up in Baltimore, you know, I grew up in a single family household, and you spoke about being a house full of women. You was the only male.
Only dude I ever lived with was a cat by the name of Halifax. That's when, you know, I always thought I was going to have somebody to help me take out the trash. I had 2 beautiful daughters I had, and my sister actually has 3 nieces, so I'm still surrounded by nothing but women.
It's kind of odd because hearing you saying you slept, you know, in the bus stations, you know, you dedicated and committed to your education. And today I think about how we transition to our kids, wanting them to do a better job than we did. Education to me was always important. And when I seen you went to Poly, I was like, well, a lot of smart kids go to Poly, you know what I'm saying? Then here you go to Tuskegee. But in high school, your classmates and teammates, they always said that you had this disposition to be mayor or be a leader, you know? And I mean, sometimes you can recognize those characteristics early on in life, you know? But why do you think that these people saw that in you? Because, you know, when the person I knew you years later after you transitioned. But what made those people see that in you early on?
Man, you did your research.
Had to.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, I think it's something. My mother was a special woman. She died. She never saw me win for city council. Sorry, she died the year before I was elected. But she was a special woman. Like, she had the ability of allowing me to be exposed to certain things, but point me in direction and rear me in other things. So, like, even, you know, this woman who sent her son with no money all the way down to Alabama. You know, it's not like we have cell phones at the time. It's not like I can text her. You know, I'm, you know, calling cards and just the whole nine. And it was always a struggle. You know, she just put something in me. I mean, even going to Poly was hard for me. So, you know, my elementary schools were Harford Heights, Yorkwood, and Chicopin. I came out of Chicopin doing basic math, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. I tell all the people time, you know, Baltimore City school system failed me until I got to Poly. And I say that because, you know, my mother was going to make sure I was in school, and she was going to make sure I was getting good grades. But she didn't necessarily know the curriculum or track I should be on. She just know that I'm bringing A's home. But when I got to Poly, I was so ill-prepared for Poly. So at Poly at the time, you had to take Algebra 2 as your first class. Now, I'm going from regular math to Algebra 2, and I started to fail out miserably at Poly. My mother found this program called Outward Bound, where I went every Saturday, and then during the summertime, you know, they had a six-week program where we stayed on college campuses, and that really helped kind of get me on track to stay in the Poly. But my first year at Poly, I almost flunked out.
So Poly right next door to Western, right?
Oh, yeah.
So was the temptation there? Because, again, I came up, we always say, you know what, man, we're going to Warburg, all those girls there. In high school, it's either sports or young ladies or women. You know, that's pretty much what we're into. And, you know, cutting class, going to cafeteria, and eating with people you aren't supposed to. I mean, we all do it. But to me, when I look at your bio and I say, you know, the man, you know, in the myth today, had to go through a transition because in Baltimore, as you alluded to, education seemed like that's secondary. A lot of guys play sports and they want to go to college for free, get, you know, get to scholarships and do things like that, you know. And your mom, she stayed on you. But when you went to Tuskegee, did you have a desire to come back to Baltimore or even go somewhere different once you got your degree? Because you was an engineering major, right?
Yeah.
How did you? Well, first of all, did you want to come back to Baltimore with your degree? And why did you once you got it?
So I always had this burning desire to come and be an elected official in the city of Baltimore. Like I always, when I was in like the third grade, Kirk Schmoke, he won mayor of Baltimore. It's the first time it was an African-American elected as mayor. And my mother, you know, not that we were connected to politics or anything. She was like a diehard Democrat, always supporting, voting. You know, I was standing in the polls, waiting to go in line to vote. I get to pull a lever, you know, but we're standing there for an hour, 2 hours, whatever. You know, I walk her from the bus to go sit down and kind of do that. So for some reason, I always had this like desire to want to lead and really want to, you know, provide for my mother in ways that I felt like the system or, you know, what public servants could do or provide for the school system. So that was always a burning desire to me. I majored in electrical engineering as a means to an end. You know, I tell folks all the time, when I graduated from Tuskegee, one of my first big purchases was a car, and it was for my mother. It wasn't even for me. I was still catching the bus, catching light rail to work. But returning back to Baltimore was something I always wanted to do. I didn't have a job opportunity in Baltimore right away. My job opportunity was in Houston. So I was actually planning on going to Houston. And my mother wanted me to go so bad. And when the job finally came available here and I wanted to come back home, she didn't want me to come home. She wanted me to go away, but I decided to come back.
So I think if my memory serves me correctly, I think DuBurns beat Smoke beat DuBurns. I think Burns took Schaefer's spot.
Exactly.
And then I think Smoke ran against DuBurns.
Right. So that's why DuBurns was the first black mayor.
Exactly.
But he wasn't elected.
Elected him as a...
Yeah, the first time the city elected a black man was
Kirk Smoke.
Yeah.
Right. And it's funny because I think, you know, when you first threw your hat into the ring, politically, it was 2007.
Yeah.
I think, unfortunately, it didn't go your way, right? Yeah. Then you came back in 2011. First, I think it was the 11th district in 2007.
You're right. This brother did all his research.
Then you came back in 2011 for the 7th district and you won. And which I think was the best thing happened for me because at that time I was able to collaborate with you in my community, which is Reservoir Hill, White Lock, and you helped me do things that no other political or elected official done since I've been back into society, which I thought was very important because a lot of times people don't understand the community needs, you know. Yeah. And you can't fix something unless you know how it works. And I know you had enough resources, but they was very limited because sometimes the scope of work that need to be done in our communities is far more than just money, you know, whether it be dealing with mental health, I mean, crime and things like that. But
the time, we were just talking about putting on a basketball tournament.
Exactly.
For the neighborhood. It was right. Like that simple.
But that was huge because there was nothing going on around there. And you think about some of the nostalgic behaviors that happens, you know, and I always say, because to me, I grew up playing basketball, you know, and to me, that was a essential part of piece that was missing in that community, whether it be bands, fun, food, and you helped me do that, you know, and I think, and that's so funny because, you know, I don't know if you know this, but statistically, we never had any problems in the 10-year.
Oh, yeah.
No, I mean, no violence, no fights, no nothing. I mean, a few people complain about trash, but you took care of that. But
I remember coming back. I know you're going to move on, but I remember coming back.
No, you're good.
And I got the word that they were going to allow us to do it.
Right.
And I came and saw you. And it's a picture because I was doing a campaign called One Piece where I was just asking everybody to pick up one piece of trash at a time. Right. And it's me, you sitting on a bench with like all these kids around us and they doing it. That's like one of my dopest political.
You remember that picture? No, exactly. I mean, I remember you came in, told me, don't worry about it. You got on the phone you got on the phone that day. You had pulled up in a car with your family. And I was like, they saying we can't do it. We don't have the permits and so on. You said, who said that? And at the time, I didn't know because we just was bootlegging. We doing everything that we thought we could do to get it going. You know, like, nah, you got to have permits who y'all talk to, and you had it done. But then after that, me and you again found our way in a major crisis, which was the Horizon.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was sad because it happened 5 minutes from where we grew up, where I grew up, and when you lived there, you know. And I remember being on Pennsylvania North Avenue, and every day you would be there. And I didn't understand why, because I'm thinking, okay, this not for a politician. This for street dudes. This for people who, and you're like, no, man, what can we do? And at the time, I didn't know. I didn't know I was a community activist at the time. I just thought I was
somebody. You just doing what you felt like you need to do for your community.
And you came, and I remember Elijah coming. Someone else, I think, meant a lot to you. I think maybe, you know, he was his mentee or he was your mentor. I think, you know, y'all had a lot in common. I think from my research, he motivated you in ways, you know, that some people didn't, you know, especially in politics. But I remember you guys on the ground with me, and that meant a lot because I remember people I thought I would see I didn't, you know. And then you think about our city on CNN every single day, and people are disenfranchised, you know. You think about the failure of socioeconomics, and then have someone black on the ground at that time in a lot. And then we went forward. I remember, you know, you was telling me that, you know what, man, I'm going to further my ambitions, and I'm going to go for mayor. And you made your announcement in the community, you know. Yeah. And I was like, wow, you know, and I think some people who don't know your story don't know about Tuskegee, you know, don't know that you went to poly, don't know that, you know, you involved yourself in a lot of, you know, to me, community activism without actually doing it because you was told to do it. I mean, a lot. What made you say, you know what, I'm going to stay here? Again, you stayed in Baltimore, didn't go to Houston, I'm going to stay here. And then the fight you put on for the 7th District or in Baltimore during that time, what motivated you to keep on? Because a lot of people left.
Yeah. I guess it's just my burning desire and my love for Baltimore. You know, I tell folks all the time, you can make it in Baltimore, you can make it anywhere. So,
yeah, you know, and look, I say Baltimore too.
Yeah, I applied to, you know what I'm saying, like, again, me catching the bus and figuring out Tuskegee, me always being threatened to put out of school because I didn't have enough money to pay for school, and the grind of like going to work in corporate America and not knowing, you know, I'm in a room with 40, 50 people, none of them look like me, none of them have my background, my experiences, and I just have to, you know, fit in and kind of fight to be able to excel in that environment. So, you know, you asked me earlier, like, you know, what put that in me? I can only give it to my mother or give it to the environment that was really poured into me. You know, we didn't have much coming up, but a lot of love, you know what I'm saying? Right. My mother was always like, you know, Nick, this is who you're going to be. And I wanted to kind of pay that forward. You know, I knew that, you know, when I saw my classmates that were smarter than me in elementary school or middle school that didn't go to poly or didn't have access to this program, and I saw the tracks that they started to take, I saw the folks in my family and things that were going on in my family. And I just know that for our people, for our communities, you know, government could do so much more. And us collectively, we can do so much more. So that's why I've always had that burning desire, because the reality is running for, you know, when I decided not to be an engineer anymore and I decided to get into politics, I didn't do it for money, obviously.
Right.
And it comes with a tremendous amount of sacrifice. And it comes with a lot of exposure and targeting. And, you know, that's what I decided to take on this pathway. I don't regret it for a second or a heartbeat, but, you know, I absolutely love Baltimore, and that's why I came back.
And you're younger than me, you know, so you was born in 78, you know, I think. And I
79.
79.
But you did your research, because right. Some reason all over the line, everybody said 78.
And I think about a young man in politics, then you spoke about the days of growing up then in Baltimore, and you entered your political career, I think, 2007, as we said, probably before when you was young, didn't know it. But then after you left Baltimore, you went to Annapolis as a delegate, you know. Mm-hmm. Explain to me what that transition was like, because now you're representing, you know, you go from representing the district in Baltimore to representing, you know, Maryland in a sense, you know, and then it's the laws are changed, you know, dramatically, because now you're representing a lot of people, you know. Yeah. How did that feel, and how was that responsibility?
It was a tremendous responsibility, and I hold my experience in Annapolis to the highest. I mean, I learned so much just as an elected official and about the system of government in Annapolis more so than I did when I was on the city council. And ultimately, that's why I came back as president to run for city council, because I knew that the council should and could be much more than how the council was shaped up to kind of function. But in Annapolis, the thing is, you know, Baltimore's a very unique place in a very diverse state. I mean, there's no other place in Maryland like Baltimore City,
right?
So the issues that plague our folks and plague our community are completely different than most parts of the state. And, you know, to, like, get your colleagues, you know, in the House it's 141, in the Senate it's like 52, to get your colleagues to understand and know the plight, the issues, the challenges, the problems, and how bills might have unintended consequences, or how bills aren't going to be the best for your city and for your people, you know, it takes a craft. Right. And I think, you know, I learned a lot there. I mean, one of my biggest, I have a couple big accomplishments in Annapolis. I would say one, you know, I passed a bill to ensure that people weren't losing their houses over water bill issues anymore. Right. So, you know, like our grandmothers was literally losing their house over $1,500 or $2,500 water bill, right? Which is absolutely ridiculous, particularly knowing that our water system was faulty and we had faulty billing, right? So, you know, that was a real old and racist practice that I was able to kill. You know, I was able to open up $18 million in GED scholarship funding for GED recipients. You know, before we had this huge scholarship program, but if you got your GED, you couldn't get access to it to go to college, which is absolutely ridiculous, right? And then the last thing I said, saving the Preakness in Baltimore. You know, when I got to Annapolis, everyone knew that the Preakness was moving to Laurel. You know, it was a huge push to do that. But imagine that you know, Northern Parkway and Park Heights sitting dark.
Right.
You know, that huge plot of land in the middle of Park Heights, and all the lack of and disproportionate amount of disinvestment over time. So, you know, I say, like, just naming a couple of bills that I was very instrumental in supporting and pushing, you know, I knew my voice was so critical in a place like that to fight for my city, and I enjoyed every second of it.
And what about Ban the Box? I don't know if that was something that you did, you know, when you was city council.
I was there, city council, yeah.
But I remember that. I remember a lot of things that, you know, you ran on, and most of all the things you ran on, you know, the principles, I think that, no, you were successful in achieving.
Ban the Box, when you bring up, that's what set the light bulb off in my head. It's like I always knew I wanted to be an elected official. I always knew I wanted to fight for our community.
Right.
But when I did Ban the Box, there was like so much visceral, like, discontent, hatred, concern. I mean, I had every CEO of every major corporation, like in the city, reaching out to me. The Greater Baltimore Committee took out an editorial in a business journal. Right. At the time, the Baltimore Sun said they were supportive. Then they came back with this huge editorial and said how it was going to work. It was like the sky was going to fall.
Right.
And I never forget, some old head came to me and he was like, if they're saying you're doing the right thing, you're not. Right. If they're making all this noise, they're going after you, it's because you're doing the right thing. And I just kept pushing and pushing and pushing. And we passed the most progressive fair hiring practice policy in the entire country for ex-offenders.
I believe it. And, you know, again, you know, we have a lot in common. You know, I lost my mom. She motivated me with saying never give up. And still to this day, I live by that mantra. And, you know, also, when I think about, you know, you created a mantra when you was running for mayor. It was from the corner to the...
I said connect the dots. You know, you can put me on any street corner or any boardroom.
Right, from the corner to the boardroom.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I thought that was very important, you know. And, you know, for me, you know, you resilient. You never gave up. You got leadership potential and skill sets. But even outside of politics, you know, if you walk in a room, you know, your disposition to me is very approachable. Like, I said, watch you on social media, you be dancing. People don't know, like, you do your frat dance, right? You know, I'm like, yo, what is Nick doing? But you be having fun, and you don't normally see that. Yeah. And I think that's missing. Again, I always use the word nostalgia because a lot of young kids who can't relate. And I always tell people, you can't fix something unless you know how it works. But being that when you embed yourself into this political spectrum and you know pretty much the answer to most of the questions, you know, and getting people, your colleagues, to join you, is that difficult when you know you're the right person at the right time?
Oh, man.
And these dudes don't get it. You know what I'm saying?
Well, see, Stokey, it goes even deeper because the thing is, the system and the construct of government has failed us for so long.
Right.
So, like, if I'm talking to a young boy and he know that his father, you know, the system failed him and right. his grandfather.
Generational curse.
So the thing is, yeah. I come to him and I'm like, hey, man, you know, this is what we're going to do. This is what I think. He's looking at me like, one, I'm part of the system.
Right.
So it's not even like for an elected official like me, for someone that's fighting for our people like me, it's not even just the folks who just don't get it because they don't share similar backgrounds. They don't have cultural connectivity. They just have a lack of understanding. So it's that segment. But then it's also the masses of our segment.
Right.
Like, this is why I need you. So I tell people all the time, like, whenever I run, I raise the less, right? Because the folks that I'm fighting for, they're not connected to donating. I mean, you did it too,
yeah.
right? You know, this whole idea and process of government, either there's something that they don't want to be a part of or something that they're just not used to cultivating or being a part of and growing. So it's a challenge. It's a challenge on both regards because you got to convince these folks that have no idea what's going on, but then you're also fighting for folks that you need to continue to do your job.
How does it feel when those folks you fight for rebel? For me, and I'll never forget, I was in Mondawmin and you had your daughters with you, you know, and the first thing you say, hey, to your daughters, that guy, he's running for mayor. And you could have said, that's the guy from the basketball court, but it was important to me that you put them on point. But the perspective was, for me, that you wanted them to identify with a black male that's doing something.
100%.
And a lot of times when we go out our way to represent people who don't know it, like you spoke about a lot of your accolades and a lot of your achievements as a politician, a lot of stuff I didn't even know about. Yeah. The Preakness is one thing I thought was something that was done from, you know, the governor's back door, right? You know what I'm saying? But to know that you fought for bills to keep it here is awesome. But does it really affect you? Do it affect you when you find out that there are people that you're fighting for who just don't get it, man? And then, like, you know, you go to work every day with your sleeves rolled up trying to fight for a bigger cause, and then you have media outlets who are, you know, establishing, you know, rumors and things that are not even important. But, you know, they say, you know, I forgot Malcolm X said, I think he said, whoever controls the media controls the minds of the people, something to that effect, right? But do it affect you when you're fighting so hard for people who don't really accept or respect the work you put in?
So, you know, anybody would be affected by it.
Right.
I think that, and when I try to talk to other elected officials, I tell them, like, you can't take it personal. Like, you gotta, I mean, the reason that you're fighting is because, you know, hopefully you understand and know the plight of where we are. Right. You understand and know our history. And for someone who has not had the fortune of kind of navigating a system or had the opportunity, like myself, to find a program like Upward Bound, to be able to go to a place like Tuskegee, to be able to come home and kind of do the things I do, who am I to look down or be mad at somebody else?
Right.
Because the same system that I know is wrong, the same system I know has biases built into them and inequities built into them, that they haven't had necessarily the same opportunities to do what I do. Who am I to look down? So you have to be appreciative of understanding. Another thing is, you know, mental health is running rampant in our community, right? So that's a whole nother segment of it. So when you put, you know, abject poverty on top of trauma, on top of mental illness, the reality is you get some really unproductive behavior that, as an elected official who's fighting for the communities that have been impacted by this, you have to understand and appreciate and step back. And you will not be effective doing the work that I do if that stuff affects you like that.
Right. So when you use your advice or your opinion or even your expertise to problem solve. So for instance, I think I read an article or I read something that said when Stephanie Rowland Blakes was looking for a commissioner, she chose Bats. I think you was a strong advocate for that. Right. Bringing Bats on board, you know, to be the commissioner of Baltimore City. I think he was from California, you know. And I always tell people, you cannot fix something unless you know how to work. And having so many smart, black, experienced police in Baltimore who can help run the city, who even was given a chance or lost it. You know, here it is, you sitting into this nice brick building downtown and making these decisions behind closed doors that's affecting people every single day.
Yeah.
When you say don't take it personal, have the ideas you presented, just like bringing the commissioner to Baltimore, been rejected? How do you move on from that? Because you got to work with these people.
You got to. I'll tell folks, how's Baltimore? Right. You know, that was my Dollar House program.
Right.
You know, where we had access to $641 million. You could take $640 million and say, like, Baltimore and all of our issues, and you can give a million here, $2 million. You could sprinkle it all across the city, right, with no plan. You know, plan meaning, like, in 5-10 years, I want return on investment. I want to have these key performance indicators. I want these goals. I want these objectives. You know, this is how I want the outcome to happen. And in 5 and 10, 15 years, I can look back and see my success, right? In order to do that, you have to be very strategic. And, you know, I really push to the administration internally and externally, and I talk about it publicly and privately, like, let's identify like one or two really big things and tackle it in a way that's gonna be meaningful for the people that were impacted by the coronavirus no one else. And I what I wanted to do was, you know, from an infrastructure perspective and from a housing perspective, rebuild our communities. Rebuild all the infrastructure in East and West Baltimore, provide access to working class folks that are currently renting, and legacy renters, they pay $1,200, $1,300, $1,500 a month in rent every single month, where they can own a house for $800, $900, $1,000 in the same communities that they're connected to and they love. And just really develop programs for affordable home ownership and affordable rentals. And, you know, obviously the administration moved in a different direction and fought me tooth and nail every single sense of the way. So, you know, recently they rolled out another Dollar House program that doesn't come with the incentives, doesn't come with the money. It really just provides to me, you know, the folks that have been taking advantage of the real estate system in Baltimore, it just provides them a added leg up and an easier way to do so.
Well, I had two friends, I don't know where they seen it, I guess on social media or some media outlet, they texted me yesterday.
Man, my phone was blown up.
Dollar House,
and
I seen you on an article with the city council president. I said, well, no, it's a coincidence.
See,
I got to talk to Nick
about it. The thing about legislation is not the title. It's the language.
Right.
So it's easy for me, like, oh, it's a Dollar House program. That's a Dollar House program. But they all don't, you know, a red Benz, it might be red, but it's totally different than a red Corolla.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, so like just looking at it from, you know, 30,000 foot level, that's how I look. But when you peel down the details, like, what are the details? Like, how is this going to put more folks that should have access to home ownership and equity in our city, knowing the racist politics, particularly the real estate politics in our city, how it's going to put them in line to take advantage of it? And it simply does it, right? I want to prioritize, you know, our teachers, our bus drivers, our paraprofessionals, our folks in DOT and DPW. You know, they should be at the front of the line, because we know, particularly once these interest rates start coming down, these prices are going to stabilize and continue to inflate. And as that happens, the markets will become less and less affordable for folks to buy homes. Right. Baltimore is not Brooklyn. Baltimore is not D.C. Like, we haven't seen the gentrification and the displacement in our communities like they have. We still have an opportunity to ensure that the folks that have been dealing and living with the crime, the grime, and the blight, that they still have access to own in the communities in which they love before they displace.
I was saying, you know, that's, that was important when you speak about the grandmothers and things like that. And so for me, I remember, you know, I seen on TV or social media, you was on a small block and you was helping Tank Javonte Davis, you know, with, I don't know, it was a community project, you know, or buying houses in his community where he came from. And I'm like, man, Nick always out front. And to me, when I see those type of things, you know, for a black man, for you standing beside another young black man, you know, it's some type of infusion, because a lot of times we don't see that, you know. And I mean, I always tell people that we don't never get to touch our celebrities. They don't ever come back and invest, the ones I know. Some of them, they leave and come back. And I think, now, I seen you doing something with Jeezy. I watch and I study people because I think it's important not to forget the ones when their name is called.
Mm-hmm.
And all the good things you do, you know, to me don't get a lot of light. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't talk about the fact that this man has two beautiful daughters. You know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? This man come from Baltimore, mm-hmm. East or West. You know, he come from the ranks of our own. You think about going up the steps from losing in 2007, come back and winning in 2011, you know, then going all the way to the Naps and coming back and being a leader of the city council, right? To me, you know, whoever write the book and edit these chapters, let's talk some truth to it. But you never run. Why is it? And I know you might say, Mom, but you never run from a fight. And I think for me, that's resilient. But as a man, a black man, knowing that we can't always put out all these fires and defeat all these rumors, but you never run.
Yeah.
Why?
It's just in me. I mean, I would say that's just Baltimore. You know what I mean? Like, that's the way I was raised. That's the way I was brought up. I know, one, everything I stand on a foundation is integrity. Right. You know, I know that everything I've done has always been for the right reason, for my community, for me being a public servant, for me not to be myself. But I'm also a student of history, particularly Black history. Right. And it's this amazing quote. I mean, I just heard it maybe about a month ago, but it just like hit me so hard. Byron Allen, the Black billionaire that owns a couple television stations, he said something. He said, I think he might have been on Breakfast Club, but he said, as Black leaders, first they dismiss you. So it's like, guy's running for this. Oh, it's Stokey.
Right.
That's Stokey from blah, 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 White Lock. That's who he is. He run for mayor, they dismiss you.
Right.
Then you get in the room, they can't dismiss you anymore because you're there. So they try to discredit you. So you're oh, no, this is what we're going to do. This is what we're gonna do. They're like, we hear you, Stokey. You're here. Whatever. We're going to discredit you. Then, you know, the people are starting to listen. So people start to try to figure out. Now they got to demonize you. Now they're like, oh, but you know this guy. You know, so this article, that article. And then if the demonization of that leadership doesn't work, they destroy you. They said, we got to figure out a way to take this dude out, right? And if you look at the history of Black folks, you look at our plight, you look at our leaders, that's exactly what they've always done. They've been able to get to the masses in a way where if they try to demonize you, and if it works, and if it does not work, they figure out a way to try to destroy you. And, you know, I thought that was so powerful when Byron Allen kind of spoke of it. And it kind of goes back to just how you live your life. So, you know, I live my life that I'm doing this for the right reason. I'm a huge believer in God and in faith. I know the reality is all that I'm putting out in the world might come back to me differently, might not come back to me the same way I'm putting it out, but I'm doing it for the right reasons. And bigger than that, I'm doing it for my daughters. Because they're sitting back every single day. They know the sacrifice. They know the love. They know the fight and the hunger I have for my community. And it's just, you know, I'm able to give to them what my mother wasn't able to give to me. And the reality is they're going to be able to give to their children in ways that I couldn't give to them. And that's what I fight for.
And it's funny you said that. That keeps me going. I have metaphors and parables that I live by every single day. I remember I was watching a video that Oprah did when she was a keynote speaker at a college. And she said, those who want the best for you want you to be your best. You know, when I see your daughters, I see your twins. Like, I can't dismiss that, right? And I'm like, okay, remind me and my kids, 90% of what I have done since I've been back in society was for my children to create generational wealth and mental health to a point where they can deal with what comes. But like you say, they try to destroy you. So I always thought it was cool for me to tell my story first. So, okay, yeah, I went to prison. I made some mistakes, but now I'm here. Mm-hmm. And it upset me. And you're one of the few people who I think got it. You know, and, it, you know, when I ran for mayor, I tell people all the time, I wasn't running to become mayor. Mm-hmm. I was trying to change the narrative to show people, listen, where I come from, change is possible.
Mm-hmm.
But then there were people who like, well, he ain't gonna win. I was like, no, the race I'm running for, I won. But when you lost, you know, you kept going. Me, I'd like, let me get out of the way because now I'm going to support my real friends because mm-hmm. they got a bigger, better job to do than myself, you know. And you speak about your daughter being a father. How difficult was it to go home and rather turn on the TV with your daughters and see somebody lying on you and there's nothing you can do?
There's nothing you can do.
Nothing you can do. But what do you do when there's nothing you can do? If that's...
Well, the reality is when you are... What I tell people all the time, before crisis... You have to have the foundation of a relationship.
Correct.
So like, for instance, during Freddie Gray.
Right.
Problems occurred in our communities because City Hall and the elected officials didn't have the relationships mm-hmm. to kind of deal with the chaos that was triggered from the trauma associated with this tragedy.
Correct.
Right. So that's why, you know, like you said, you know, maybe somebody run for office. They'd be like, hey, Stokey, I want to sit down and talk to you.
Right.
You've been doing this work for a decade.
Right.
You've been here. You've been there. Like, why you want to talk to me now? Right. So it's this whole thing about relationship. And I bring that back to my daughters. Like, they know who their father is.
Correct.
Right. They see me every single day. They know, you know, when I call them, when we talk, they see the fun. They see the connection. They know exactly who I am. So when something comes up and now it's not just television, you know, they're on social media.
Right.
So it's their homegirls DMing them with something or it's them swiping through and seeing your mommy this or daddy that. And all, you know, you have to have that relationship. And I feel blessed because I couldn't imagine two stronger young women in the ages that they're in, 13 and 15, seeing this and processing and going through all this. I mean, all the changes and stuff that a young girl's go through at that particular time and putting this on top of it. I can imagine stronger young women to go through that. But it's just going to coming out of all of this for all four of us.
Right.
It's just going to make us individually and more importantly, collectively stronger.
You spoke about God and, you know, to me, religion kept me grounded. You know, my daughters don't play about me. You know, they older. And I mean, like, you talk about on social media, I could be dead wrong.
Yeah.
Stokey was in Lexington Market with a, my father don't go next month. You know, they going right. at it, right? Yeah, and yeah, I yeah. understand that. And I try to tell my daughters, don't get caught up in the myth because you can't, you know, one thing, you know, about social media is undefeated, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And you can say something about people and now with AI going on, you know what I'm saying? They can have Nick
deepfakes
in the White House, yeah, you correct. Know, like, that ain't me. You know, I swear to God, that ain't me. You know, that ain't you. But, yeah. you know, besides politics, I think that we all make decisions in our life, and I'm going to give you a chance to expand on some things that you think. But before we go further, I want you to grade Baltimore, you know, from the top to the bottom in terms of the political landscape. Some people might say, well, I'm going to give D.C. a minus B because of the violence in the Southeast, you know. Yeah. And I'm going to give, you know, Chicago a C-plus because of Rahm Emanuel, the mayor, whoever he might be, or the lady Bedford, whatever her name is, you know, the mayor of Chicago. She made some poor decisions with the chief of police, and now everything is running rampant. How would you grade Baltimore today if they say, you know, Nick, based on your 4 years or 3.5 years being city council president, you know, working, you know, beside, you know, a young black mayor in Brandon Scott, you know, having a whole pool of other city officials that may agree or disagree, you know, with our political ideology, what do you grade Baltimore?
So before I give a grade, I'll set it up this way. Like, there's no place in America like Baltimore.
Correct.
And here's why.
I agree with that.
Look, we got the water to our east, mountains to our west.
Right.
45 minutes away from the nation's capital. We got the fourth largest city from us, 100 miles away in Philadelphia. We got the Big Apple, 3-hour train ride, a car away. When we talk about our institutions, you know, we have cultural institutions. We have the best hospitals in the world. We have educational establishments. We have HBCUs. We look at our culture. We look at our history. We look at our housing stock. Everything here is in Baltimore in a way that's so packaged, if you laid all that out, you'd be like, man.
Right.
That literally is the greatest city in America. I mean, when you just lay out all of those characteristics, right? So then when you put all the other stuff on top of that, right, and we look at the way our policies have been done, when you look at the lack of opportunity, when we look at some failures from a leadership perspective, and you play all that systemic stuff out to what are we getting out of it, I get really concerned. And here's why. There's no other place in America where your congressman is black, your governor is black,
your mayor,
your Annapolis delegation. You know, when we look at the Black Caucus in Annapolis,
right.
It's the blackest Black Caucus ever? Out of any state. Blackest Black Caucus. The Speaker of the House is a black woman. Your mayor is black. Your city council president is black. Your comptroller is black. Your city council is majority. So when we talk about, you know, how does a system that has been inherently flawed in impacting our communities, how can it be changed? And we tell folks to continue to vote for
right.
us,
right?
And they keep seeing us in these positions, and they're not necessarily seeing the change or results that they want right away. It's a problem. And I think that we all have to take a step back and just appreciate that for what it is.
Right.
See, the reality is, you know, we can continue to fight for social justice change all we want, and that's what I do, and that's what I've been doing, and I've been very successful at passing laws forward. But until we go after an economic paradigm shift in our community,
right.
where we're giving folks access to own businesses, access to own property, and we have that recycling of dollars in our communities that we're disproportionately disinvested in and that we're structurally let out of systems. I mean, that's why we have the economic apartheid that we have all around the city. Until we're able to dismantle that, we won't be able to get out of this rut of all these amazing characteristics. And when we look at the racial wealth gap, when we look at health disparities, when we look at crime statistics, we look at all these other things that we stick out like a sore thumb. Right. So as a person who is so deeply connected to my community and want to fight for our community, I say that at best a C.
Right, and so because I thought the same thing you thought in 2015. We had a black president, right? We had a black attorney general, we had a black sheriff, we had a black assistant or lieutenant governor, we had a black mayor, we had a black city council president, we had all this blackness, right? And still, Baltimore's like it was ignored from a socioeconomic perspective, because then the riots happened, all the money came to Baltimore, and now I go down Pennsylvania Avenue, and then you come up with the dissent decree, you know, and like, okay, now police on pause, because now they don't want to go to jail, they don't want to get arrested for doing that job. You know, and to me, I was like, wow, this is the time where we move forward. I was excited, I'm on the ground, you go into all these meetings with all these political administrators and all these things that make sense at that moment. But now here it is almost 10 years later, I'm saying to myself, wow.
What's changed,
right? Mm-hmm. And I think individually, again, some people like you who keep fighting, you know, deserve their flowers. Mm-hmm. There's certain people and for some reason, and I said it to Sheila, I said it to him in the face, and I said, I want Brandon to win. I love the brother. We never had any issues. I wasn't running against him. I was running with him to change Baltimore. And I always told people, if for some reason God said, you know what, I'm going to move all y'all political experience people out the way. I'm going to do a Donald Trump on Baltimore and make Stokey mayor, right? I got to call Nick. What I'm supposed to do with the state of body? Nick, you know, Nick, listen. What I do to state of address? What I do city of, what I do, Nick, you know? I know I couldn't do it myself, but for some reason, you know, he hasn't called, which is fine. No, I called you, Nick. I need you to bat a basketball game. You show up. Mm. And I'm like, yo, people don't understand, to me, the power of relationship. It goes back to what you said earlier, you know. And I think in order for this thing to work, some of us may get it, some of us don't. But I always believe in using our resources that we have available to us to fix some of these problems. You knew on day one when you came to Pennsylvania North Avenue that you needed somebody that was in the community that had a relationship with the people that either could cause problems or solve them. You called me. Mm-hmm. I was there, and we didn't lead to his resolve. That's the same thing going on around Baltimore now, and I'm not talking about just crime. You speak about mental health. You know, we talking about the squeezy kids from people fighting in Maryville. You know, I remember how some of these problems were started, but I think together, collectively, when you think about, you know, whether it be, you know, the social gap, education, recreation, all these problems that we face every single day, you know how to fix it if you have ammunition. Mm-hmm. So you can go on any corner in Baltimore, I believe in my heart, as you can right now, mm-hmm. and say, stop. And they go, Nick, man, what you got for me? Mm-hmm. And you say, I got this. They gone. But without that element to give them, why leave?
You know what I'm saying? Why should they?
Right, you know what I'm saying?
Like, in what part of the world, in what society, of what group of people, what if you're doing what you got
to
do
to survive?
You're doing what your environment has taught you is normalized. Right. You're doing what is pumped into you through social media, through music. You're doing with, like, why would you just change because some random dude showed up or
exactly.
told you, hey, I'm here and you shouldn't
help.
Be doing this?
Right, you know what I'm saying? That makes sense.
Help
right?
is on the way. Just wait.
That never happens.
Just go in the house, wait, help will be here. For you. You're not going to do it, right?
Right.
But somehow we have this idea that we expect our young men to do it. Like, right. so then, and they don't do it, they go down some wrong paths, and, you know, we leverage the media, and it's all a way of making money to demonize them. Exactly. You know, that's why we could turn on the news and look at, I mean, there's some great things happening in Baltimore City schools, right. And in the worst of the worst communities statistically that we'd never, ever hear about, and it's for a reason. Right. I mean, if something positive happens on the corner of wherever, North and Duklin, it's not going to be no cameras there.
No.
If something real negative happened there, you're going to have...
Because you know who controlled the media. Yeah. You know, and a lot of people don't understand how that works. You know, and I was in a meeting before with a person who wanted me to say something or do something to align myself against, you know, Maryland. I'm like, no way. And I'm sitting to myself, like, why I'm here? And why y'all do
that? Why is that so important to you anyway?
Why you invite me? And then I understand how the paradigm is being shifted, because a lot of people, if you throw them a grant or a few dollars, they gone. And me, that never
did. Say it one more time.
If you throw a grand or a few dollars, they gone. And I'm like, yo, that can't be me. I can't be controlled by the masses just based on this temporary
man.
Fix, you know?
Out of being in politics, I'm glad you said that. That's probably the one thing that hurts me the most. Like, you have somebody, you feel like they real, they about to work, and then you go like, yo, this is what we got to do. Like, oh, no, I'm going to stay this one out. Like, what you mean? Nah, well, you know, I just... And then you see that they moving a little different.
Man.
And then you find out they got some grant.
Exactly.
Or some organization is... And he's like, wow. So that's why this thing of... You know, I went through the line of elected officials. That's why that's never really going to be the answer for our communities until there's, like I said, an economic shift in our communities. Because... You know, back in particularly black cities in like the 50s and 60s and stuff, they say, you know what? We're going to concede the political arena to black folks. Black folks are going to start getting elected.
Right.
And we can no longer control these jurisdictions that are predominantly black. They're going to start getting elected in these jurisdictions. We just have to figure out a way that we still control all the dollars. So when you look at black cities, you know, you might have a strong political base of black leadership.
Right.
But then start looking at the economics. So that when we look at the racial wealth gap here in the city of Baltimore, it's as scary as anywhere else in the country
with all
of this black leadership, right? So that's why you have to continue to push the mantra of, like, what are we doing from an economics perspective to better our communities, to better our people, to put folks at the table at seats that they necessarily wouldn't have in the past?
What would you tell 18-year-old Nick?
Oh, man, a lot. Man, that's a tough question.
Because now you already know what's to come, you know, and you know what you would change. But what would you do different? Because again, you know, you had your mom, you had your grandparents, you had your sisters, you know, growing up in Baltimore, you know, and then, you know, your mom and dad being from two parts of town. But I think, you know, there was a moratorium that was created in our generation where it went from having fun to having to survive.
Yeah.
We used to have fun, then we had to survive. And you spoke about inescapable conditions in Baltimore, whether it be guys on the corner or guys squeezing. It's certain things that happened from a socioeconomic perspective that made us feel like we had to do these things. But we had choices, you know. And I went to college for real estate psychology, but I was committed to that fast life, you know. And to your point earlier, telling kids not to do something without something to give them is, you know... You know,
it's a dummy mission.
Exactly, you know what I'm saying? But the 18-year-old, you know, Nick, what would you tell that person?
I would tell him to, you know, continue to clearly go to college, do what you're supposed to do. I think the one thing that if I could rewrite history and change, I would have aggressively secured resources and finances for me and my family. You know, because when you decide to run for office, like, I gave up a lot. At a very young age, right? When I was on, so I look at my contemporaries, I look at my folks that I was working with, you know, when I was building cloud storage data centers as an electrical engineer, and I look at what they're doing today, you know, I wish I still would have had the same level of focus on my community, but just from a resource financial perspective, built that up to then come back and run for these offices.
Right.
And this is getting real deep, but, you know, a lot of times, you know, many of our folks that kind of get in these positions, you know, sometimes they don't have a necessarily a career to fall back on. Like, this kind of is their career. And I had an advantage where this wasn't my career. I gave up my career to be in public service. So I might have would have delayed it for 10 years or something to just be more prepared, you know, for my family from the sacrifice that that I had to go through.
You had other jobs. You were with Verizon?
Then I went to Constellation PG&E.
So you was a blue-collar guy, so it's not like you can't go back. But before we get totally out of politics, you know, which I think you did an excellent job, what makes Nick happy? And I know it's a broad question, but I think it's important for people to know, you know, like, outside of... You know, what y'all see me doing for y'all is some things I want to do for myself, you know.
Yeah.
And sometimes we get shortchanged because, you know, we are so selfless. But sometimes you got to be selfish. And that's a hard thing to do when you are elected to represent people. They don't think that you get time off. What do you do on your time off and what makes Nick happy?
I would say, I'm actually working on that, you know, trying to figure out how to be more selfish.
Right.
You know, and I think probably a lot of it stems from the way I grew up. Like, you know, being around all these women, being the man of the house, but not having the resources or right. the strength or the presence, you know, when my mother got into something or this bill came up or this electric bill was turned, you know, not being able to, like, be there to support them, but being, quote, unquote, man of the house, I had this thing in my mind where when I grow up, I'm going to be the man. Like, I'm going to be able to take care of everybody. right. So whether it's my nieces, whether it's my sister, whether it's
now, who
my
the wife, oldest?
My sister's the older. She's okay. I have an older sister.
Okay, so you didn't have to worry about nobody, you know, looking after your little sister. You had big sister.
Yeah, yeah, correct, okay, correct. Good. Yeah. Right. And really, I had two big sisters. My my cousin grew up like a sister with me. But, you know, when I grew up, I'm like, you know, I'm just take all the responsibility of everybody.
Right.
But nobody can do that, right? No. But you build this false sense of, like, what you're supposed to do, really trying to make up maybe for, you know, what I saw as a young kid growing up in the South. So I say all that to say that, you know, it's really about, you know, you got to take a step back, right?
Right.
And sometimes you can't be there for everybody.
No,
sometimes,
you
know what, like, I don't have it. Or, you know, I can't. Sometimes you have to be selfish. Like, oh, I'm going to do this for myself. Because the thing is, you can't pour into other people if where you have is at a deficit.
A friend of mine told me, he said, man, this joker keep asking me for money. If I give it to you, you're going to have more than me. So you got to learn how to say no. And yeah. I said, man, that's hard for some people.
But particularly, I'll say this another thing that we don't get. Like, so, like, for many of our generation, you know, we were the first.
Right.
So, you know, when I graduated from college, I made more than anybody else in my family, like, right away.
Negro Ricks.
but so then you got school debt, right? You got trying to keep up and support folks and be there for folks because you feel like that's your duty, that's your job. And I don't take none of that for granted. I don't take any of it back. You know, I'm blessed that I was able to bless and I was able to be that way because right. now, you know, I've got younger cousins that are coming up and my children, you know, so I'm thankful to be in a position to kind of do that for my family. My sister went to school and she graduated from college. So, you know, my mother just couldn't be happier about what she created. But a lot of times we don't necessarily see, you know, that part of the story. So, right. so like my colleague or my contemporary, you know, the guy that gone to college, maybe his father went to college, maybe his grandfather went to college. He come out, you know, no student debt, you know, go to buy a house. Right. Parents give him money for the house. Wedding, parents give him money for the wedding.
Credit card,
limit. When we start out, we already start with a deficit. Just off the position that we're kind of in, and again, I take none of that back because I know when I'm in a position to lead, or when I know things are challenged, I know that we are able to adapt in ways that other folks who have never had to come over any adversity would just fail.
Right.
And so that's why I don't take back any of my experiences of going down to school and all the issues I had with school and getting out of school and helping and supporting. It's just really preparing me and make me better. The one thing that we have to do. It's take care of our health.
Now,
because with all these lived experiences and learned experiences, you know, when you die, a lot of it goes away, right? So
right.
it's really about being healthy enough to be wise enough so I can see that young Nick at 18 years and be like, hey, Nick, do this.
Yeah.
No, don't do that. You know, I mean, because you don't know what you don't know.
Yeah, the important thing for me is when you try to train or tell young folk what not to do, and they like, this guy old, he don't get it. Like, yo, I've done that before. I've been there. You know, like, yo, he only talking about, man, you let that old head on. I'm like, yeah, but listen, my mistakes to you are free, you know.
Correct.
So even when you say you're working on being happy, you know, I know you like to relax and, you know, you smoke cigars, you chill. Is you the man cave guy or you the ESPN guy? And I mean by man cave, sometimes you might be in the man cave reading a book, you know, just going over your day, chilling, or you in front of the TV arguing and fussing about how...
I mean, it's March Madness right
Jordan
now.
Jordan is better than LeBron or, like, you know what I'm saying, getting the arguments, you know. Because you go, I think we share the same
vibe. Maybe I'm bipolar, man, because both seem good to me, you know what
right,
I mean?
You know, I tell people it's a generational conversation because,
yeah.
you know, you can't compare, you know, what I say people wore Converse back in the day.
Yeah.
They were successful. You know, world champions scored 100 points in the Converse, right?
Put me on some of the Converse and tell me to go play basketball.
So now you look at it, it won't make sense.
Yeah,
so I think when you think about what Jordan did for the game of basketball and what LeBron is doing, you know, because my son, you know, he loves Jay-Z for his accomplishments, but music-wise, he don't relate to that, right? And I always tell people all the time, you're getting a nice car with a young kid that's 15 and you 50 and you playing the OJs, the ride ain't the same.
Yeah.
But if you playing some little baby and a young boy, that's that's the rise. So yeah. I think it depends on where you are when you entertain, you know, these conversations. But I always want to know, like, outside of politics, what do you like to do?
Pour into my girls. So, you know, have fun with them. Hang out with, you know, whatever.
Right.
But, that, I mean, I don't have any specific hobbies where I go skiing.
You know, baller.
I go hiking.
Yeah. I ain't going to catch you on CNN, you know what I'm saying? Playing polo.
Yeah, like. Yeah. But, no. You know, just, I guess, you just, I love sports. I'm a huge fanatic of basketball and football.
HBCUs, you know, which I think a lot of us, when CIAA came to Baltimore, you know, I seen that you was on the ground with Jeezy, Young Jeezy, you know, you was doing some type of community initiative, you know. How did you feel about the CIAA coming to Baltimore? As a black guy, because we've been to Charlotte forever.
Now it's home. I was so excited when I lived Baltimore. When Visit Baltimore.
Right.
I was able to lure the CIAA. Right. I mean, because, you know, you got to imagine, most of the schools are deep down south, North Carolina right. and it's South Carolina, all that. So they're like, you know, why are we going to go all the way up to Baltimore? You know, not only the commissioner, but the presidents and the elected officials around there, like, just really pulling on them. So bringing them to Baltimore was a huge just undertaking in itself. Then we get COVID. Now we got a tournament, but it's not really a tournament. It's virtual, and we're trying to do stuff virtually. So then it's the stigma of crime. It's the stigma of all the stuff that kind of Baltimore brings with, but I couldn't be proud of our city.
Baltimore did this thing.
If we see the tournament and we've seen how it's grown, not just in attendance at the game, but at the quality, like activities and events that happen around our city, and the economic impact that it has during a time where it's really a down period, the bigger thing about it all, Stokely, is the residual effect. Right. So when you get folks come from all across the country that see Baltimore in a way that Hollywood and New York is not going to be, that the national news is never going to paint. When they come to Baltimore and they go to a black-owned restaurant, or they come to Baltimore and they're getting service by this young black, or right. they come to Baltimore and they're able to go to the regional, they're seeing all this cultural stuff that is just not normal in where they're from. And that's why I'm saying, like, when we talk about all the characteristics of our city, it's so unique in a way that if we ever decide to collectively come together and really push for the change that we desperately need, I mean, it's off the map. That's why there's no other place like Baltimore. That's why I love our city. That's why I tell people all the time, we have to be the strongest advocates and messengers for the city of Baltimore.
But before we end, because I know you got to go, I think you got some unfinished business to do in Baltimore. I think you're running for a re-election. Why? I know you say C plus C minus, but okay, you know, Nick done been in Baltimore politics, you know, for a long time, you know, and you done the best you could do with what you had. Is the fight, like, we both love Baltimore. Sometimes, man, you know, somebody say, if you pulling me or you dragging me, you know. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, so I'm going to pull up and drag, right? And sometimes I know it feels like that, because even when I'm helping people and it seems like it's to no avail, and then you think, man, like, how long can I do this? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You know, you have done it on every level. You know, why continue to do it? Outside of not loving Baltimore, because it has to have been something, you know, another element other than love. Why?
I think, and I could be wrong, but I think in 50 years, 30 years, 20 years, whatever, like, this is going to be a defining moment of our city. And either we're going to step up in a way that cultivates all the characteristics that I laid out earlier about how our city is so great and how we need to continue to uplift and empower our communities and our people, or we're going to turn into Brooklyn. We're going to turn into D.C. And I'm right. serious. So right. I think Baltimore has a responsibility for our nation. You know, with all the...
Something to prove.
Yeah, that you can build the people who have dealt with all this crime and run and all the unintended consequences or intentional consequences that policy has played on our community and plagued our city and created all these systemic issues. You can empower those people to really do great things, own their communities, own their economics, and build up there. And I think that we have to have leadership that's prepared, responsible, and intentional in place to do so. And when I look at some of my colleagues, and when I look at this field of folks that are running against me, it's simply not there. So, you know, I think that I represent that. And I think that, again, if we do it the right way, that we can be truly proud of what we're able to build in a city like Baltimore and defy what has been normalized as it relates to rebuilding a community. We can rebuild Baltimore responsibly with the folks that are connected to these communities by empowering them to own their communities, to have access to wealth in their communities, to build businesses in their communities, and see that dollar recycled in their communities. That's what my mission is.
Now, and I think, for you to sit down with me and give me this opportunity to ask you questions and you answer them, and more importantly, you know, your commitment to Baltimore has not been unnoticed. You know, I want to wish you well, man, in all your future endeavors, man. I appreciate you for always answering my call. Individually, collectively, professionally, politically, you always been there, you know, for me. And even when I was on White Lock, just trying to get a trash can, you was there, you know. And I feel the same way you do about Baltimore. I'm hopeful that we can come together collectively and build more small black businesses, you know, and evolve and help each other and come up with a plan that gives everybody the hope that these young kids need to see to prevail in the future, man. But it starts with guys like me and you. So I want to thank you for doing a good job, man. And, man, you know, you continue doing the work for the people, man. And I wish you the best, man.
Appreciate you, bro. Yes, sir.
Tell them I remove the curses. If you tell me our school's gonna be perfect. When Genesis don't exist, tell them that's when I stop saying you. Say hello to the bad guy. Hello. They say I'm a bad guy. I come from the bottom, but now I'm mad fly. They say I'm a menace. Hello. That's the picture they paint. They say a lot about me. Let me tell you what I am. Say I'm a bad guy. Hello. Say hi to the bad guy.